Welcome to Season 4 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Josh Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former Commissioner of Health in Baltimore City. Our goal is to bring scientific evidence and experience to current topics in public health through engaging interviews with scientists, community leaders, policy experts, public health officials, clinicians, and more. If you have ideas or questions for us to cover, please email us at publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, we return to a tradition at Public Health On Call, the Friday Q&A episode. I speak with senior scholar from the Johns Hopkins Center for Health Security, Dr. Amesh Adalja. I pose a whole bunch of questions we received through publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. Let's listen. Dr. Amesh Adalja, thank you so much for joining me for a question and answer podcast. We haven't done one of these in quite a while. How are you doing these days?
I'm doing good. COVID is still a busy topic that takes up almost all of my time. But from a patient care perspective, and I practice in Pittsburgh, it's been pretty good. And I think that's because Pittsburgh is a place that we have a lot of people, especially the high-risk individuals, vaccinated. So we have cases, but we don't necessarily have hospitalizations, which I think is the best scenario to hope for.
Well, I'm glad to hear that. You ready to jump in?
Sure.
All right. First question from one of our listeners. I am fully vaccinated with the Moderna vaccine. If I catch the Delta variant, will I acquire additional immunity in addition to the immunity from the vaccination?
It's likely when you get a natural infection, you're going to be exposed to different proteins of the virus that are not contained in the vaccine. So you likely will get a boost to your immunity, and maybe some different elements of your immunity will get stimulated with the natural infection. So I do think that those breakthrough infections probably leave a mark on your immune system, one that probably gives you protection that's not necessarily contained in the vaccine. It might not necessarily be better than what's in the vaccine, but it's probably different immunity because different proteins of the virus are seen by your immune system with the natural infection.
Great. Now moving to a question about the potential problems with a breakthrough infection. Someone asked us whether the awful things that can happen with a regular COVID infection in an unvaccinated person can also happen through breakthrough infections like long COVID or potentially an increased risk for heart attacks and strokes because of the changes to the vascular walls that might result.
Generally, the answer is no, that when you are vaccinated and you get one of those rare breakthrough infections, the immune system jumps into action so quickly that any of those bad consequences are not something that you're going to see have a major impact on your clinical course. That's the whole goal of the vaccines. It was to not prevent every breakthrough infection, but to make breakthrough infection something that's mild, something that's not really clinically that significant. And that's what we're seeing. That doesn't mean that there haven't been breakthrough infections that are severe. I've taken care of 3 patients in the hospital with breakthrough infections. But in general, when you get a breakthrough infection, it's not something that you can associate with the same complications that you would get with a natural infection. And that's why vaccination is so important, because it really removes the ability of the virus to cause all those serious problems, the serious problems that actually brought COVID to our attention.
Great. Thank you. A couple quick questions for you. Is there any evidence to suggest that COVID-19 can trigger adult onset asthma?
There's no specific evidence that adult onset asthma can be triggered by COVID-19 specifically, but we do know that people with respiratory infections and of all sorts can develop what we call reactive airway disease, where the airways in your lungs go into spasm. They may have symptoms that are similar to asthma. So there may be some of that that happens with wheezing that might occur post-infection. But if you're thinking that you might have developed asthma, we know that asthma is something that is a autoimmune condition and it can get triggered by certain infections. So it would be important to see your doctor and get formal testing to see if you think you might have asthma. There's ways to tell whether or not someone has developed asthma.
Thank you. Now, here's a different question. When a person breathes in a droplet that has the SARS-CoV-2 virus that causes COVID-19, how long does it take for this virus to start binding to receptors in the nose and throat? Is it seconds, minutes, hours, or days?
That's a hard question. I think it's probably going to fall within minutes to hours. This is my best guess at this. It's probably not instantaneous. It takes a while for the virus to get to places where those cells are, depending upon which cells are getting bound to. So I would say probably minutes to hours, but then it takes time. That's what we talk about during the incubation period, time to develop symptoms because there's not enough virus there. But you know, it's an interesting and it's a cool question. I'm sure in a petri dish or in a laboratory, it can be done. It's done in seconds, but in your human body, it's a little bit more complicated because there's mucus there. There's little hairs on your cells that are constantly beating, trying to remove debris like viruses. So it's hard to know exactly what the time course is down to the precise unit of measurement.
Maybe someday we'll get some videos of that happening and have a better sense, but not yet. Next question. Somebody has read on the internet that people who have the mRNA vaccines will die in 2 to 4 years because variants will become more resistant. What do you say to that kind of internet rumor?
It's just an internet rumor. There's no truth to that. It's basically an arbitrary statement that has no evidence behind it. What we know is the best way for more variants to emerge is for people to not be vaccinated, so the virus has more people to infect freely. I think it's important to remember when you think about whether or not a variant is going to be more deadly or not, you've got to have to think about it from a Darwinian perspective. And what I try to do is put myself in the shoes of the virus and say, what would the virus want to do? The virus wants to infect more people, and it wants people that are infected to go about their life and infect more people. A more deadly version doesn't really fit the Darwin. What would select it? What would make it want to be more deadly? What it wants to be is more contagious. The less you interrupt someone's life, the more contagious you're going to be. That's why many common cold viruses are so contagious, because people go about their lives. So I don't really think this is a major risk. I think lots of people talk about this, but it's clearly not if it were to occur, it's clearly not going to be the vaccine that really drives it. It just doesn't make sense because the vaccine deprives the virus of people to infect, and it needs people to infect to generate more variants.
Thank you for that. Another concern, I think driven most likely by what people read on the internet. Someone wrote us, I'm worried that if I get vaccinated, I will give my infant child an increased risk of getting sick from a COVID variant. Is this true?
No, it's not true. The best way to protect your infant child who's too young to be vaccinated is for you to be vaccinated, because that makes it much less likely you bring COVID-19 or any of its variant forms into your household. So that's the best thing you can do to protect your infant.
Now, in line with the idea of protecting infants, someone wrote us, my daughter got a COVID-19 vaccine while she was still pregnant. She's now breastfeeding her new baby and wants to know if she gives some breast milk to her 3-year-old, will that child also get antibodies?
Yes, they would. Anybody that drinks or consumes that breast milk would get antibodies. So even if you drank your wife's breast milk, that might be gross, but I'm just using it as an example, that would give you antibodies. It's present in the substance of the milk, and that's how it confers the protection. So it's just there.
Well, there you have it. Next question. Do masks get less effective depending on how long they're worn? I'm in an office for 8 hours of the day. Should I bring more than one mask?
It all depends upon the type of mask you're wearing. So most people are wearing kind of hospital style procedure or surgical masks. Those are usually intended for single use, but obviously, you know, surgeons wear those types of things through a surgery. So I would say for several hours with that type of mask, it's probably fine, but you can sort of tell when it's not becoming effective because it starts to fray, it starts to itch your mouth, it starts to get dilapidated. Some of the cloth masks that have multiple layers, those probably can be worn without really an issue with them wearing out over the day or even over days.
Now, someone wrote us, I'm vaccinated, but my coworker who works only 3 feet away from me is not. If my employer lifts all restrictions, am I at risk to get sick from her?
So there's a couple of aspects to this question. Number one is, it's good that you're vaccinated because even if you were to get a breakthrough infection, it's unlikely that it would be severe because the vaccines will do their job. If you're somebody that has some immunosuppressing conditions or you're really worried about getting a breakthrough infection, what you can do is wear a mask yourself if you feel uncomfortable in that situation. And some of this is going to be dictated by a person's risk tolerance and their risk preferences, because breakthrough infections are going to happen and they're going to be mild, and it's going to be impossible to completely avoid them if people start to interact with each other, even with other vaccinated people or with unvaccinated people. So I think this kind of comes down to your own risk tolerance, what your risk factors for severe diseases. And if you're uncomfortable you can always wear your mask voluntarily, even if you're vaccinated, and that will decrease the chances of a rare breakthrough infection occurring.
Here's another question from the workplace. A listener writes, I am a middle school chorus teacher. I work in an area where parents are done with masking. I think I will be expected to teach multiple chorus classes of 20 to 50 kids indoors. I'd love some expert advice on how I should run my class.
This is a difficult question. You could probably write an essay on how to reduce the likelihood of cases there. So number one is you yourself should be vaccinated. Hopefully as many of your chorus members as possible can be vaccinated if they're all above the age of 12, and hopefully we'll get approval for younger age groups. So that makes it safer. I know you said it has to be indoors. If you could make it outdoors, that would make it safer. If you can't, having it in a place where you can open windows and increase ventilation would be good. And remember, you know, chorus singing is a little bit different than teaching algebra class, because we know that's where we can get farther spread. There's a lot more particles generated when people sing. So that's why we have to be a little bit more careful there. You know, the point is, if you're vaccinated also, that your breakthrough infection is likely to be mild, but it's likely to occur in that type of high-risk situation. The other thing you might want to do is, maybe you can't have them wear masks, but can you have them wear face shields? Can you put up some plexiglass barriers, especially if they're unvaccinated individuals in your chorus? But it's going to be something that you have to kind of be flexible with and kind of tinker with to try and get to the right level of mitigation, and at the same time be able to still do the chorus class. But it's challenging. But outdoors is always the easiest answer when it comes to these singing types of things.
Yeah, it makes me wonder whether there's just such a high risk of outbreaks. Maybe there won't be that many classes because the kids will all be at home.
Right. I think that if those kids are going to be amongst the highest risk for getting, especially if they're not vaccinated, for getting infected because of the route of the level of exposure is going to be as high as it probably can be in any school activity.
All right. Last question for you. My parents, someone wrote us, say they will not get the vaccines because they have no comorbidities and there will always be some variant. So eventually we will all get it anyway. What do you think of this way of thinking about it?
So it might be true. It's an efficiently spread respiratory virus that's now become established in the human population. We will all definitely get it at some point, but I would rather get it after I've had a vaccine so that I know that it's extremely unlikely to be severe, especially as you get older in age. Yes, there's going to be more variants, but when it comes to the way our vaccines work, they're designed to stop serious disease, hospitalization, and death, to make any breakthrough infection very, very mild. So the best and easiest way to take out all uncertainty that COVID doesn't disrupt your life, even if everybody's going to get it, is to get it post-vaccination. So it's a milder disease, more like other respiratory viruses we deal with year in and year out. But the only way that happens is if you're vaccinated. Because if you're not vaccinated, it's a little bit of Russian roulette as you get older in age for whether or not you're going to have a severe case, whether you're going to have a mild case, whether you're going to end up with long COVID, whether you're going to have to take time off from work, whether you're going to have to tell all your friends and contacts that they've been now exposed and they have to go get tested. All of that can be avoided with simple vaccine.
Dr. Adalja, thank you so much for giving us the answers to these questions, and good luck with all your work.
Thanks for having me.
Public Health On Call is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmond. Audio production by Spencer Greer, Niall Owen McCusker, C.N. Oates, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo and Neiman Outland. Social media support from Brenda Hageter, Grace Holz Fernandez, and Caroline Wong. Thank you for listening.